So this panel is part of an SFI obsession with limits, limits of human performance, the limits of society, the limits of cognition. And we've had over the years numerous meetings on it. The most fun one was when we did it with the Navy SEALs and Red Bull, which was kind of interesting. And I think we all felt very limited in their company. But on this panel, this will be chaired by Jessica Flack, there at the end, who you might have met already once, introducing our panel. And Jessica works on collective intelligence, issues of causality, upwards and downwards, and what are the limits of our individual abilities and what happens when you put us together? Do we get smarter or more stupid? That kind of thing. Sitting next to her is my reprobate brother, John Krakauer, who you've met. Surly, angry, and but a darling, but a darling. And John, of course, works on both real human beings as a neurologist, but also as a neuroscientist in limits of performance, and has worked very closely, actually, with NASA on the Mars mission and on the issues of what the astronauts could tolerate in terms of that kind of limit. And we have a new SFI faculty member sitting next to him from Yale, Brandon Ogbunu. And Brandon works on the interaction between the organism and the environment, the cell in the body in an ecosystem, humans in culture, and the complexities of that nonlinear set of interactions and what they generate. And finally is Jorge Almazan. And after you gave that talk, we just thought, wait a minute, you know all about spaceships. you know about small, you know about self-organizing communities, and presumably on a long mission, a mission to Mars, that's exactly what would happen. I mean, the rules would be broken, and so you're going to have a unique insight into the architecture of outer space. So I'll turn it over to Jessica.
Thank you, David, and welcome, everyone. Sort of exciting to be moderating this panel on, I think, one of the most important questions before us, which is, what are the limits in front of us as we explore the cosmos, and how can we overcome the limits that we encountered here on Earth in that process? And so what we're going to do today is have a conversation about different kinds of limits and how we might overcome them, from neurophysiological limits that individuals experience to social and psychological limits and to collective limits, how we might harness collective behavior to make better teams in exploring the cosmos. That's my own interest. As David said, I work on collective intelligence. Another way of thinking about what I work on is as collective computation. So I really study the foundations of computation in nature. And almost all of the biological and social systems out there are collective. So this problem is this problem of how nature computes, of how we solve problems, is fundamentally about how we solve them together in groups. And not just as individuals coming together in groups, but how we can generate synergies. And to improve our and enhance our team performance. So before we jump into the conversation, what I want to do is just hear from each of our panelists what their own research interests are and their own outlook on this problem of overcoming limits is. And that will ground put us, I think, in a position to have a nice conversation. So John, why don't we start with you?
Yeah, so I work with patients, athletes, and we've always been interested in how to measure and how to train and how to enhance performance. I got involved with NASA. They asked me to consult and assess how you're going to do two things with astronauts. How are you going to assess their cognitive and motor capacity, and how could you potentially train away some of the deficits that you detect? And it's a huge challenge. The point that's at the heart of all this is human beings are going to have sensory motor deficits from space travel, they're going to have cognitive deficits from space travel, and they're going to have psychiatric deficits from space travel. I thought it was interesting when Nina mentioned that 2033 is now when we think we're going to go and pick up those samples on Mars. When I was sort of consulting at NASA, it was 2027, so I'm sort of interested to see how much this creeps out. But you know, we can get into just how incredibly difficult it is to contemplate this, because it has no relation to what's already happened. And you know, only 12 humans have been on the moon, and absolutely no neuroscience of any kind was done on them. And I can tell you more slightly frightening facts about how little we know.
Great, thank you. I think on the evolution side, I work on problems like phenotypic plasticity, how an organism survives a range of environments, works on trade-offs between traits that are kind of adaptive in one context and maladaptive in another, and this obviously plays out in this situation. But on the cultural and the more macro side, I like to think about the question of whether or not this space travel problem, how unique it is, and it is, right, obviously, but what analogs exist for it in other contexts on Earth. One of the things that I've actually started working on is prisons, for example, and solitary confinement. I've written about that. So there are these analogs about that type of isolation, and what can we learn about that that we can port over to this other problem? Lastly, I've written about things like, you know, the pandemic and lockdown, and even things like for basketball fans in the audience might remember the NBA bubble, right, which was this adaptation that we made culturally to deal with things, and they were kind of behavioral things that shook out there. So, you know, I hope to approach this from many angles. Thank you.
It's working, right?
Okay. Well, I must say that I felt victim of my own lecture because I was defending spontaneous behavior and so on, and here I am being spontaneous. So I'm practicing my own theory here, but I recognize it's difficult. I would say, if we look at architecture and if we look at cities, I would say that human beings can live in all kind of conditions. So we see human settlements in all kind of, I would say, weathers and climates and you know, all kind of conditions. But over time, we also see patterns, very clear patterns, how the size of the villages, how they socialize, how they develop certain behaviors, etc. So I would say that maybe for a short mission and having in mind that kind of limit of time, maybe I don't know how much time, maybe humans are able to kind of resist and be mentally healthy and physically healthy for a certain period of time. But when it comes to really being there for a long time, I think they will develop probably very similar patterns to those that we find here on Earth, probably. So I think we should start thinking about that, about, you know, like, how do we socialize in space? How can we, you know, where are we, our children going to play, for example? How are we going to treat the elderly? Maybe our civilization now is not treating them properly, right? Maybe we have to develop other ways. There are so many questions, but I think we can start really observing what is going on here on Earth. That would be my point.
Okay, fantastic. I think I'd sort of like to start with the bottom, which to me is the neurophysiological limits. And when we're having this conversation, it would be nice to sort of hit on several poles. So on the one hand, short versus long missions. So, you know, like thinking really out of the box about what might be very long timescale things down the road, as well as the low-hanging fruit. And then also thinking about what we know doesn't work here on Earth, and using that to leverage our guesses about challenges we're going to face as we explore the cosmos. So let's start with the neurophysiological limits. What are some of the neurophysiological limits, given what you said, John, about not knowing very much about how we respond in space, that you expect us to have to overcome?
Yeah. So there is quite a lot known about sensory motor physiology. It's just important to know that there's not been much work on the moon or anywhere else. It's been a lot of stuff in shallow orbit. And then there have been some humans and animals spending, you know, 6 months a year in the International Space Station. Just starting from the real problems are, you know, balance, coordination, eye movements, and the vestibular system. This sort of the heart of the neurophysiology of space is the vestibular system, you know, and in particular, your utricle, which is your system that can detect linear acceleration, which is a system that is driven haywire because suddenly gravito-inertial forces are gone and your utricle suddenly is going WTF, right? And there's an enormous amount of work showing that there are significant short-term and long-term effects on your vestibular system and its projection into the brain when you're in low gravity. And it's hypogravity, which is the big challenge, right? There are these moments of high G when you're accelerating and decelerating, which we can talk about. You know, the moon is about, you know, 1/5 G. Mars is about 1/3 G. And there are lots of issues just going from low G into high G again and low G. And those transitions are hugely problematic. Okay. And to your question, Jessica, those problems get more problematic the longer you're in one state versus another. So the Mars mission is going to be a year. No one has the slightest idea what it's like to be in hypergravity for that long, right?
That's what, 10 months to get to Mars, is that correct?
Yeah, and so there's that whole issue of hypergravity. What can you do to try, and that was stuff that I was involved in. Can you put people in centrifuges to give them some hypergravity while they're in low gravity? And then that, and the problem is the longer you're in one state, the harder it is to transition to another state. That's really very dangerous because for days you're helpless. You can't operate machinery. You can't drive. You might not even be able to open the spaceship. You know, when people come back from the moon or coming back from the shuttle, they have a whole team there waiting to pick them up, right? They're helpless, like babes. That's not going to happen when you go to Mars. There's no one there to say hi.
So, John.
Right? So there's all these issues. And then all of that, there's a whole physiology in that. It's not pretty. Then it gets cognitive, where you go, you can't aim for targets, you're inaccurate with instruments, another real problem. And then, of course, the psychiatric ones, which are the only ones you can actually recreate on Earth, like Brandon was saying, you know, isolation, hating everyone around you, no sex, all those kind of things that come up. But the physiology for cognition and movement is a real problem, and we really don't know, and I can go into more detail about it, how hard it is. And then most of the work being done now, just to finish, is on rodents, right? So the Russians sent up in 1959, I think, 42 mice, along with two dogs and one rat and one rabbit or something like that. And we now do a lot of work on rodents, and it's extremely questionable whether rodents are going to be what we want to study to guess what it's going to be like for us cognitively and psychiatrically.
So John, are there since we don't know what we're going to encounter, we don't know the human response to these environments yet, for the most part, are there neuroscience tools that can be given to the astronauts to do repair in real time? Is there anything like that on the horizon? I mean,
yes, there are some very unusual contraptions for motion sickness. You know, things that grab onto your neck and apply pressure to your cervical musculature, special shutter glasses to deal with problems with velocity integration in the brainstem, which is thought to be the basis for motion sickness. So there are all sorts of doodads. The problem is our experience is that astronauts don't want to be instrumented. You can't actually monitor astronauts second by second. Are they losing concentration? Are they not sleeping? Are they beginning to mess up? They don't want to be monitored. Okay, so that's a real problem, right? Because they don't want to look unfit, because then they might not be chosen for the mission. So it's very interesting. And then a lot of data, I mean, you know, I was talking to someone at Biosphere 2. All those data have been lost because they went mad by the sounds of it, right? The roaches took over, the hummingbirds all died, and they went mad. But all those data apparently have been misplaced. So we just don't know very much about any of these things. And yet here we are saying we're going to pick up our samples in 2033. I mean, maybe I'm just a pessimist.
Brandon, do you have anything you want to add?
I don't have anything on, you know, I can't really speak to the specific neurophysiological things. I think what I think about when you ask that question is how this interfaces. It's like there's several types of interventions that we can make, like for these types of problems. I think they're like strictly biological ones, there are technological ones, and there's like cultural ones, right? And these things overlap in some ways. The biological ones are, those are funny. That's like, we're not going to evolve to be able to, you know, live it here in any, you know, reasonable time scale. But are there interventions at the CRISPR-Cas space? Or do people differ? I'm curious about this. if you look at this room here, do we differ physiologically enough that we can actually identify people who are better at being able to survive in that environment?
Just to answer that, yeah. So in other words, there's been a lot of attempts to sort of screen for who's going to be good in space. The Russians have a test that doesn't seem to actually bear out in terms of evidence, but it's still applied. It's really, really difficult, actually. Yeah. And again, we haven't done the experiment. You can send people to the polar ice caps. You can go up into the space station. But it's not going to be the conditions under which you're going to be a year out, a year there, and a year back. It's almost like trying to predict the stock market or pick people at university. You know, we know that a lot of that is fiction.
So what about some of the social and psychological limits and tools we might use to overcome them? Go ahead, Brandon.
Well, like you know better than most people. I mean, I think from the collective intelligence to this to the stories now about the optimum size of a team and what the members of a team are, to kind of minor breakthroughs in psychology, to how do we treat neuropsychiatric disease in a certain way. I think all of these paradigms are things that, you know, can conceivably be improved upon to address the problem of, like, who, you know, how are you alone for long periods of time, et cetera. I think what's interesting about, like, this process of selection, I'm really interested in talking about, because the process of selecting, one of the things I've read about in this framework is that the process that we use to select individuals to go out of space right now, we're selecting for traits, right, to get through things that are talented individuals who are good at a set of tasks and have been selected in a school system for a certain set of behaviors and tasks, but those things are not the types of things you want in an individual in space for a long time, right? You actually want collaborative identities and not competitive ones. You want people who are actually, you know, and so I think how are we going to solve that problem, which actually is a strictly cultural one, right, with these biological implications. I think this is what I mean. I think it's the knobs that need to be turned to solve this problem exist on all of those fronts. They're pharmacological. There are certainly kind of appendages and devices and things like that that can help. Certainly there's new psychiatric drugs that can help. Certainly things like, I don't know, for me, you know, games and things like this that build cohesion between groups. These are certainly cultural inventions. So I think thinking about how to turn which knobs and how and when are the types of things I think about in this space.
We have to send teams into space who both have a kind of military command structure and also can collaborate and do science research. I mean, so switching between these very different tasks, one team, fluidly, seems to me a huge problem. What are there solutions that are being discussed to, not just in selection, but in facilitating these transitions between these different social structures?
I mean, there's a huge amount of work, right? In other words, just a very concrete example that came up, I think somebody mentioned this. You know, you have an attack of appendicitis halfway to Mars. You know, and there are delays of seconds with contact? Can you do telesurgery? Can you do some telemedicine and coach people through? All these things are coming up all the time. But I just want to say one thing about this. We're talking a lot about, and at NASA there was a lot of it, you know, what can we do to pre-train, to pre-select, to reduce the transition time between Gs and all that. But the real truth here for everyone is, you know, I remember at the Empire State Building, 5 people died building it, and it was considered a miracle that only 5 died. 27 people died when the Brooklyn Bridge was built. Since Qatar was given the World Cup 10 years ago, 6,500 migrant workers have died. So I think we're just going to have to accept a fair amount of carnage here, if it's important enough. I mean it. I'm saying that this idea that we're going to optimize and find ways to find the perfect 5 basketball player equivalent, and they're going to be, you know, Ocean's 5, and it's all going to work out. We can do all that, and we can try and minimize, but, you know, 15 astronauts and 4 cosmonauts have died since space travel in the last 60 years, and my guess is that we can send as many mice and rats and non-human primates up into space, but what we're actually doing here is a massive human experiment where all the actual lessons are going to be answered while we do it. I was involved, we're trying very hard to be preemptive, predictive, mitigate things, But make no mistake, this is going to be a giant human experiment where we're going to consider the mission sufficiently important to sacrifice large numbers of people.
That's very glum, but perhaps realistic. Jorge, do you have something you might add in terms of the sort of design mistakes we might avoid in terms of thinking about missions and the ships that we build?
Yeah, I think, well, we can start looking at the mistakes that we do actually here on Earth. And one of them is functionalism. I don't know if you have heard about this concept. It was invented in the 20th century. And basically, it means thinking rationally and assigning to each problem a functional solution, right? We think rationally. And we kind of forget that human beings are not always rational. And cities, in fact, solve that issue through liminal spaces. By the way, there was someone in the audience who mentioned that, and she observed that many of the spaces that I showed were liminal spaces. Liminal means, I think from the Latin limus, I think it limits, right? So human beings somehow, and this is one of the patterns that we can see in all cultures, except those that were made in after functionalism, which is kind of very artificial, is that human beings need certain states or certain situations in which they can evaporate, in which they can forget themselves and get a little bit crazy. And all the cultures, for example, in Europe, you have the carnivals, right? The festivals, right? Ray Oldenburg, one very famous American sociologist, was talking about third spaces, which is there was one kind of space completely forgotten by rationalists and by functionalists, which is a space which is different from home and from work. A space like a bar, for example, like a library, like a barbershop, the kind of spaces that you had on maybe the main street, an old American main street maybe, and this you can still find in Europe, also in Japan. And it seems like human beings need to disconnect sometimes, and cultures have developed some ways to do it in a, let's say, not chaotic or messy way so that we don't kill each other or something like that. And therefore, we had like festivals and carnivals, and maybe some cultures develop some controlled, you know, like drinking habits, or maybe some other, maybe native cultures develop other kind of strategies, very controlled, so that you can keep that irrational side of the human being, but still make it work. And all these debates that I hear, I think they are kind of focusing too much on the rational side, but how about how to control, how to let astronauts evaporate maybe for a couple of hours and forget having some kind of relief from those all those constraints? I don't know, I wonder, this is my question. Is there something about that in the field?
Yeah, I think that's an excellent point. And I think it's good to put on the table three constraints that often direct these conversations: the financial and efficiency constraint, the survival over thriving constraint in these particular settings, like exploring the cosmos, and then also the hard to measure constraint. And I think your remarks are a good segue into this. I want to focus a little bit on the hard to measure constraint. So, and I'll go to the basketball to use basketball as an example. So I work, as I said, on collective computation and collective intelligence. And one of the things I'm very interested in is how you measure synergies between individuals. So synergies are interactions that are more than the sum of the parts, more or less. So where you have two or three people interacting and you can't decompose it into their individual contributions. And in sports, this has not really been something that sports analytics folks measure, but those of us who watch sports, and of course the athletes, and I'm sure the sports analytics people, can see that there are these synergies in play. And just as an example, if you watched the fabulous documentary, Michael Jordan's documentary, The Last Dance, I think it was episode 7, in which Steve Kerr describes Scottie Pippen as bringing the harmony to the court. And this is something that's just not been quantified, you know, and we don't know. I mean, maybe it's just an anecdote. Maybe, you know, maybe it's just a feeling we have and it's not really something that's playing a significant causal role in the team performance. But we have other anecdotes that suggest these synergies do play a role. And so how can we design the space, design the sort of cultural, the normative system, design the interaction rules to enhance collective performance and start taking into account or cultivating these kinds of synergies that might be particularly important for the unexpected tasks that astronauts are going to face?
Well, I mean, actually, just by pure coincidence, some of us, Josh June and I, who are in the audience, we went to see the Phoenix Suns headquarters a couple of weeks ago, and you know, they famously managed to make themselves very good by actually focusing on the collective, because they didn't have the top players, right? And they spoke very interestingly about how, if you know what you're doing, you can elicit, you can confer upon one of the players that kind of ability by the way you coordinate them with others. But the problem is, Jessica, is that required Monty Williams, you know, extremely famous coach, has been doing this for a long time. We don't have any space coaches, right? Because we don't have the slightest idea what the synergies should be or what the coordination should be. Now, if you were to keep it just to the idea of what kind of combination do you need so people don't start killing themselves over rice wine, which we heard about earlier, right? Which is actually very true. One of the most terrifying things about being in isolation is that people will go off on the smallest thing, right? And it's not clear how to stop that from happening. But so maybe, Jessica, we could do it for the psychosocial part. But for actually being competent over that time course, no one has any idea.
But we do, for example, there's work in neuroscience, as we discussed earlier, studying, for example, how kids perform in classrooms and looking at and to the extent to which their brains are in coordination, their common neural oscillations, and how those are generated and the context in which those are desirable. So, and then, as I said, you know, with this basketball example, we have tons of quantitative data on sports now, where you have different teams or different organizations pursuing different strategies, like the star player strategy versus the synergistic collaborative, you know, team, where you have individuals contributing, as I think Daryl Morey once described, so on the Lego being the kind of Lego block that links everybody else up. So there is work on which to draw, in order to better understand these kinds of things.
It's just very task specific. So there's a basketball way of doing it, there's a hockey way of doing it, and there'll probably be four people in a little tin can for a year way of doing it. It's just we don't know what that is because we've never done it. That's my concern. I mean, there's this horrible curse of task specificity that gets us into trouble over and over again.
No, I mean, I think you said something very important just now. The task specificity, and it could be a basketball problem, it could be a hockey problem. This is actually a very important point because these different tasks lend themselves to different types of rules that govern the way that the interactions play out. So, famously, soccer, right? Famously, you know, you assemble an elite soccer team with you select all these great individuals on a soccer team, and famously, like, that doesn't actually work out as well as that does in basketball, because I think, you know, soccer style tasks are one where the team is basically as good as the worst part of the team. So whatever the fragility is actually ends up dominating and dictating what actually ends up on the field. Whereas basketball, you're pretty much as good as the best player on the team, which is why you add LeBron James virtually to any backbone, and the team is automatically significant. And so this is a critical question, is outer space a soccer sport or a basketball sport? And we do not know. We do not know, but I think to the point, we now have a framework to be able to ask that question. Now, not for the long-term stuff. You've already shot our hopes down about long-term stuff, John. But at least for short-term trips, I think this type of work can get after what type of sport is that exactly?
Well, I mean, coming back to the space point, I mean, just to make, to advocate for basketball, since I'm biased around basketball, it's a court, right? Small, right? And there are, you know, five people. But are there other, you know, what about space and other domains? Like, do you have any sense in which space can sort of bring out individualistic versus synergistic behavior? Is that too far-fetched?
Yeah, well, I think, again, I'm trying always to try to see patterns across cultures, and all humans need some private space, of course, but also they need that kind of social space, right? That's kind of very, very, very basic. I would say that for example, there are studies about communities and the size of communities. I know that we are talking about probably few astronauts, right? Few people. But there is a certain number of people also that seem to work better than others' numbers, right? So maybe one key issue here is if we send 20, 10, 3. I don't know. I think that's super important. Yeah. At least when we design collective housing, for example, and you want to share a patio or something, if you try to share among three people, it's not going to work. They are going to end up splitting the patio, right? But if you start putting 20 people, then you have a whole different range of subjectivities, and it's easier to kind of be social in that situation. Of course, two people is not also working, right? So I think our possibility of survival in that psychological meaning, I think it depends really pretty much on the number of people, I guess. I don't know if there is any discussion about that. I think it's completely different if we send 3 or 20.
Yes, I mean, just I think that's a really critical point. So Jessica doesn't think I'm trying to be contrary for the sake of it. It's definitely true that when you have a clear mission, whether you're a Navy SEAL or a basketball team or even going to Mars, it's a very clearly delineated mission. You have a very specific set of skills that you have to sort of, as I said, Ocean's 11 meet. And you can definitely pick people, and there is generalizable evidence. How do you get a team to go on a mission? How do you protocolize that mission? That's all true, right? And maybe it could work. But that's
not going to be so mission-oriented any longer, because there are multiple missions now.
Right, but I'm just saying that's what makes it difficult. But it's very different to data, for example, on shipwrecks, where when did you have a Lord of the Flies scenario and cannibalism, and when did the people seem to get on until they were rescued? And there are fascinating data on successful shipwrecks on islands and unsuccessful shipwrecks on islands, right? And other work when people are thrown together, and then, you know, Biosphere 2, right? When they were there and they had to sort of do multiple missions, like you say. So there's like a sort of like a spectrum between these are the missions, these are the levels of expertise, and that's what they did very successfully with the space shuttle, and they've done it with shorter missions. The problem is does even a low-end mission that goes on for 3 years turn into Lord of the Flies, even with a small number of people, right? And that's, we don't know.
So let's try and think about some solutions. So in the collective behavior world that I come from, one of the insights is that noise, which we often think is detrimental, something that we want to get rid of because it's confusing, that noise can actually enhance organized behavior. And so this is a well-known result. It's been around for a long time. There are different versions of it. But for example, like you inject into an experiment where you study fish. Fish are shoaling, and you want them to school. You inject some noise. The noise actually amplifies the fish individual trajectories, the directions that they're moving in such a way that it causes the organized state to the fish to move into the organized state more efficiently. And so that's just one example. And another one comes from the work of Nicholas Christakis, who was here a week or so ago giving a community lecture on a panel. They did some work years ago in which they injected noisy bots into some human coordination problems and were able to sort of compensate for the negative behavior of the humans and generate more efficiently the desired response of the group. And so I'm just thinking, what are some creative coming technologies and concepts, maybe through the AI connection, that we could use to, again, tackle problems that we suspect will come up in this setting?
Something came to mind when you were talking, so it gets after some of the things you talked about indirectly. In terms of wacky, maybe counterintuitive, maybe surprising paradigms that I think might be useful. There's a whole institution full of extremely irrational actors that we deal with and we have dealt with for centuries, and we have a lot of data on, but perhaps we don't lean into it enough. And that's, you know, like daycare and children, right? Like the organ, how they're organized and that institution, right? And so that those are deeply kind of erratic and irrational actors by and large, depending on the age. where we've actually done a good job at the science of that, and the science of early child development is actually quite good in terms of what a child needs, and it's long term, and it takes dynamic properties of the way they're developing. I think leaning into that, because I think there's more analogs in paradigms like that, and I'm not arguing for that. What I'm saying is that we need to be there. I think we're going to get some useful. We need to be imaginative with regards to the type of data sets and frameworks that we look to.
But what about thinking about this AI human team dimension? So when, you know, I say bots, it's essentially artificial intelligence. How could we design think about the bots that Nicholas injected into these experiments as being part of the human team, right? So what about that, John? I mean, what do you think, what's the potential there for correcting behavior that's going awry as uncertainty arises, unexpected uncertainty?
Yeah, I mean, you know, we just had we were given the money to start a project, I don't know where it's going to start, of social robotics, a cute little robot that can be there that you can stroke, like a little white little seal. So I think everyone is thinking, I was at a meeting, an army meeting several years ago, where we were talking about sort of the R2-D2 effect. Could you have an R2-D2 with you? So you're up in space on the Mars mission, obviously you're Luke Skywalker, and you have your R2-D2. And I think there's a lot of interest in that. You know, can you offload some of the work? Can you get rid of some of the mundane tasks? Can you give more leisure time? Can you have a social robot? Can you have hybridization between, you know, being helped by the AI? Yes, I think there's a lot of that, and that being discussed a lot. And then there was the other side, which was VR and AR, just to have more holodeck-like experiences, like in Star Trek, you know, to relieve themselves of all the tension, they go into the holodeck. And there was very much this idea, is can we do better with VR and video gaming so that you can have some sort of deeply pleasurable experience and forget where you are, even though you're in a Coke can on the way to Mars. So both of those, I think, are absolutely very real and huge amount of work being done on both fronts. I mean, I remember discussing, thinking wouldn't it be great if you could have a tail, right, or a six finger, and be much more useful in space with this extra appendage and things like that. All of that is in play, and I think you're right. Those will mitigate.
Brandon or Jorge, anything to add on either of those points?
Yeah, well, I was thinking that, in fact, these kind of experiments are already happening in Japan. You might know that Japan has a huge issue of depopulation and aging, and therefore they are trying, and that's one issue. Another issue is that kind of immigration is a taboo, right? There is no discussion about that. Therefore, they are very seriously, my colleagues in my Faculty of Science and Technology, they are very seriously considering robots, yeah. And very seriously considering all kind of virtual approaches and AI approaches to, for example, care, right? I must say that I am a little bit, I don't think there are certain aspects of like the humans that might not be possible to do through robots. For example, I am very skeptic about the utility or usefulness of taking care of the elderly by robots, because I think that there is something else that we still don't understand about caring, for example, care, right? This is one of the neglected aspects of human beings that is also reflected in our cities. We forgot spaces for care, right? So I am a little bit skeptic about that. I don't know if we are going to really manage to kind of compensate all those needs, for example, through those super long trips, and maybe through virtual reality, we can simulate like social interactions and care through some kind of devices, put it that stimulate our brain and so on. I think that sounds like science fiction, but we are not so, at least my colleagues are quite convinced that this is going to happen. And this is in fact a kind of national policy even. I mean, you can get many research grants if you research about these kind of issues.
I mean, the robot that we have is a Japanese robot that we're going to try it with. But just to say, you know, I've been directly involved in studies in aging facilities with gaming. And I have to tell you, I mean, the longest we've gone is 12 weeks. So 3 months of gaming. And of course, they do that simultaneously being with their friends, right? Not like they, so we have no idea what it would be like. But nevertheless, it's kind of interesting that, you know, the elderly and maybe astronauts can get to like gaming characters, virtual characters. I mean, I was speaking to the students the other day that, you know, there was this incredible uptake and personalization of the dolphin, for example, and they bought themselves a furry dolphin and turned it into a companion and a trophy. So I think the one area where I might be more optimistic, because otherwise I sound like, you know, Maleficent, is that we may be able to do work with social robotics and gaming and virtual reality. Again, whether that's going to be sufficient for 3 years, 1,000 days, but, you know, I think with Telelink up, I mean, we all Zoomed, right? And, you know, it's going to be much worse than Zooming for 3 years, but there may be a way to mitigate, I think, with AI, VR, gaming, robotics. But I just don't think that's, just to be clear, that's second order. I mean, I think we can do all that. But the other first order, medical problems, just the sheer difficulty with cognition, physiology, neurophysiology, and psychiatry, maybe the psychiatry will be mitigated by some of the things I said, but I just think the problems are still very first order difficult before we get to these things. That's my concern. If we could get over the first order stuff, I'm a little bit more sanguine about the second order stuff, but I think science fiction is only fun because we can get on to the second order stuff, because it's boring to listen to John talk about the first. I don't want to talk about the vestibular system. I want to talk about space opera, right? And I think the problem here is we're all getting ahead of ourselves, because we don't really want to know how hard the first order science is.
Brandon, do you want to make a final remark before we?
I think that's a proper couching of the problem, right? I think that, but you know, if to try to make the first order problems at least a little bit more reasonable, maybe for the conversation. I mean, if you look at the range of human performance physically, right, it is really quite astonishing, right? And if you look at what people are doing in a lot of paradigms physically, it was far past the imagination of what it was even just a generation ago. I mean, if you look at 100 meter times, for example, I mean, there was the debate about whether a human being would ever run, right, like, you know, below a 10.5, 100 meter dash, and we that's been smashed like multiple times. So I guess what I mean is, you know, you don't want to place limit. We've been wrong every time we've placed physical limits on the imagination for in terms of what humans can do physically. And I think when you take kind of whatever it is about culture that's allowing us to kind of continuously crush these records, and you supplement that with technology, and potentially even, and I'm not a CRISPR-Cas, I'm one of those CRISPR-Cas skeptics in terms of my technical work, but for certain kind of clearly heritable physical morphological traits and things that we could understand and measure, I think when you think about these things in combination, some of the first order problems, right, we can think about solutions for. Okay.
But just ask yourself, if you have to be a supreme athlete at the far end of the distribution in order to be able to do this, then how on earth is it ever going to scale?
So one final question. And when we think about collective effects, we're usually thinking about, you know, coming together to win a basketball game. We're not generally thinking about using collective effects, leveraging collective effects to solve neurophysiological problems. But I'd like to just push on that a little bit. Like, could we imagine designing a space and a set of cultural norms that allow us to harness collective effects to solve some of these first order problems? And maybe we don't solve them in an individual, but we make sure the deficits that individuals have are sort of compensated for by other team members, for example. Like, this is a hard question to answer. I'm putting you a bit on the spot. Mm-hmm. But I think it's one I don't often hear on the, it's not one I don't often see on the table.
Well, briefly, I mean, so like the conversation, some of the conversation around prison reform actually lives here, believe it or not, right? Like, if you look at the data on what happens to a person in solitary confinement, I mean, it's kind of unbelievable, right? The how rapid the regression is, and how destructive, you know, physiologically we have measurements and data on these things. And some of that conversation about, like, how do you take a person who society really doesn't like and make sure they're punish however you feel about this issue, right? But still, right, how do you reorganize a space in this way such that it's still kind of like physiologically, you know, human in some ways? So I think these things do relate, right? How you organize people do, and I think the prison reform conversation actually is a lot more, it's a lot more physiological and a lot less humanistic and moral than you would think in that regard. So that's one paradigm I know where that conversation's been had. That just came to mind briefly.
Before we move on, could you give an example for, so how would a person who's been in solitary, is there a sense in which other prisoners, when that person comes back out, their interactions are leveraged to bring the neurophysiological responding back up? Is that where
So it's like, I mean, some people just want to abolish it altogether because it is, you know, it's a zoo condition. But I mean, there are kind of various ideas about this. There are windows of time. There are exposure to sunlight. There are these things that we know. Diurnal variation has these kind of effects. John, you can speak to this. So I think there are various models out there for how you do this in a manner that's humane, but the humane part is tied. So there's a lot of different models. I think one of the models on the table, of course, is just to abolish it completely. But I'm just going to give it, I'm giving a quick example. We could talk about it more.
Any other remarks?
Going back to this issue of first order and second order, I wonder if we are being a little bit functionalist in that sense, like separating factors, right? Like saying, well, before talking about socialization, well, before we have so many problems, like let that aside. Our collective experience during the pandemic, I think, showed us that, in fact, things that we thought were not important, like talking with someone, you know, meeting people in person, etc., seem to be very important for our mental health, right? I think in every country, there are data that the mental health issues have increased a lot. So it seems like this subdivision into first and second order, that line might be more blurred than we expect in many aspects. And I'm talking as a completely lay person, but I think our collective pandemic experience showed that as we needed more of certain things that we thought were kind of dispensable, basically. So I am a little bit, maybe it's important to talk about those issues now.
All I'm saying is if you're vomiting uncontrollably and you can't walk, then those things are not really going to be in your mind.
Yeah, but I appreciate the point that it's like the liminal space point too, that sometimes there are certain solutions that we think are too, they're indulgent, when in fact they're required.
Mm-hmm. They're critically important. I'm just saying it would be nice for that to be our problem, even though it's going to be as difficult to solve. I completely agree. I mean,
briefly, just to throw it out there, another the conversation around torture has actually been more physiological, like a lot of the human rights stuff than one would think. That's another paradigm, right, where, I mean, even in war now, there are supposed to be rules for what you're supposed to do based on what we know about the effects. Long-term effects.
All right, thank you guys. I think now we open the conversation to the audience. So we'll, yeah.
Howdy. I'd really like for y'all to discuss a case study or experimental system, if you will, that addresses these sort of collective action psychological and sociocultural problems, and even to some extent the physiological problems that's existed in human society for basically its entire duration, which is seafaring. And from my personal experience, Jessica, you mentioned the difficulty of having to fluidly switch between creative, collaborative, scientific tasks and strictly hierarchical structures occurs on ships all the time. We do it all the time. How do you think that this can translate to help address some of these issues that you're raising now?
There have been whole books actually written. There's a book, I believe it's called Bold Endeavor, which was written in the 80s, which specifically looked at long sea voyages and polar exploration as precisely the model to look at and to think about this much more in terms of long sea voyages, right? Again, this is none of, I just found some of this stuff kind of interesting to read. But yes, there's a specific people have argued for that parallel and have learned from it. Again, I was much more involved in cognitive and sensory motor mitigation and measurement. I wasn't getting to that psychosocial dynamics of polar exploration, Arctic camps, you know, floating away on ice slabs and things like that. I'm just not sufficiently familiar with that literature. Right, vomiting. I can talk to you much more about vomiting and falling over. Yes.
I just have a question about first order breathing. Seems to be a really basic thing, that needs to be addressed right from the start.
I don't know. I mean, it's, you know, that's true for all of us coming to Santa Fe, right? We first get to Santa Fe, it's altitude. We hyperventilate, we get a respiratory alkalosis. We have to start compensating that by peeing out more bicarbonate in our urine. And then we start to increase the number of red blood cells we make. Our liver sends out a signal, right? So, you know, there are all sorts of, and that's really important. The short-term changes to high altitude, long-term changes to high altitude are directly paralleled by the neurophysiology acutely and the neurophysiology when you're out in space for months and months. And they can, that they can go in opposite directions, and they can be fine until you then go back into the place you used to be, and then you have this awful space sickness on transition. It's like the bends when you come up from the depths. But, you know, yes, all those things, I love all that stuff, right? But that's underneath. That's what I'm calling first order. And then there's all the stuff, you know, when you start, you know, hating each other, which is layered on top.
I've been hearing you say, you know, I can't, about what am I going to be doing if I'm vomiting? Like, that's the first order of things. But I like thinking about what's happening right before that. There's been plenty of times where I've had conversations with people that led straight to getting sick. And so I might be more along with what you're talking about in terms of, like, that line being blurred, you know.
That was great. What?
There was a comment?
No. Okay. I really appreciate the sobering perspective on that. So I wanted to, again, I want to try to think of a cultural facing aspect of the topic. And it seems that it's not a trivial matter how the public will deal with that carnage that's to come. Yeah. You know, Challenger and Columbia are great examples. The history of the artificial heart back on Earth. You know, advances that are contextualized in the sort of courage to fail spirit. Nonetheless, carnage comes, programs get put on hold for years. It's not a trivial thing, is my point, along with all those other problems you're describing. So I was thinking of what work needs to be done in that regard in the cultural facing side. Like, this is worth it as a community, as a global problem or a national one. And maybe to turn it into a personal way, clearly all of you have sort of made the wager it's worth it. Could you, could argue to us why you have decided it's worth it with all the tragedy that's to come?
I don't think I've said it's worth it. I mean, I think there's a big difference between having an elite small team like NASA's going to train to go and do science and learn important things about Mars. I'm just saying that's a very different conversation from having Biosphere 2 on the moon or on Mars. And I think that the science, the psychology, the politics, the economics of Biosphere 2 on the moon or Mars is a totally different conversation from wanting to see whether we can find evidence of ancient life on Mars and sending up an elite team to do that. Obviously, there's some conceptual subterranean connection between those two, but those are totally different things. That's why when Elon Musk is talking, I mean, it's just all such nonsense, right? It's just, we couldn't even do it in the Arizona desert, right?
But I think there is an important distinction between what's going on now, space travel now, and seafaring and so forth that's come before biosphere. We are at, this is different in the sense that we have AI developing. We have the capacity in a way that we never had before to analyze vast amounts of data in real time. And so that makes for a substantial reduction in risk. And the mistake is to think that the AI can do it all. Obviously it can't, and we have to deal with tail events, right? So the humans are going to be the ones making decisions about tail events because we just don't have AI yet.
But just so I understand that, we have all this AI and we can't even deal with gun control in our own cities. In other words, I mean, there are many, many complex problems that I can make directly analogous to having a biosphere 2 on the moon, and we can't even solve them on Earth with AI.
Gun control is a moral problem.
So is sending lots of people. It's like going up Everest, and John Krakauer, our namesake, showed what happens when you send amateurs up Everest, right? So I think that these are similar. I think we're very, very techno-utopian about this, and I don't quite see why.
Okay, one more question, are we done?
Okay. Yeah.
Oops, I'm sorry.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, everybody.